My name is Chris Bookmer. I'm part of that Spexels Ars Electronica quadcopter swarm team. That's a lot. Yeah, I mean, if I just say Spexels, it's absolutely meaningless. So it's an Ars Electronica quadcopter swarm. That means that we fly a swarm of quadcopters with a single flight control system we have developed. I'm mainly concerned with the business management and the project management of the product. So I'm always on site for shows and stuff like that, but there might be some technical questions I can't answer, but then there might be trade secrets anyhow, so we'll see how far you go, okay? I'm a little fighting with the drone because it should do some light animation, but at the moment it's not communicating, so maybe it works a little afterwards. In general, this what you see here is a recent show we did in Sweden, in Umeå, that's the European culture capital of Sweden this year. And this was the first time we flew in winter conditions. We've had minus 10 degrees and snowfall, and worked on a frozen lake. And really surprisingly, it worked. I was just always with this kind of contracts, you say, yeah, it's going to be fine, but you never know. But we could manage to fly under these adverse conditions, and it was really very successful. And this is practically the EUMIR logo, the logo of the European culture capital. This is insofar very interesting because our drone manufacturer said that it might be tricky to fly up with minus 10 degrees because of the batteries, because the most important issue with drone flying is the batteries. Their lifespan is pretty limited, so if you fly for 10 minutes, it's okay, but everything else than that is going to be tricky and depends very much on the wind and the conditions. So in this case, we flew 5 minutes, and during our flight, we realized we could go longer. So this means that next time when we go to the Antarctic, we can probably fly even longer. This is the whole Spexel system. I don't know how aware everybody is of that system, but the idea behind the drone flying system is that we decided that we might need a new kind of visual display in the sky that's really transformative, that is not just flat, it's not 2D, so it just uses the open airspace in a city. That's why we're always talking about urban interventions in public airspace in a city. And the idea was to turn to generate flying pixels, and then the discussion was, how do we get them up there, the flying pixels? And after discussions about bumblebees or other things, we came up with the idea to use quadcopters. And what you see here is a scene from Sweden where we have that fleet of quadcopters checking their LED system. And the trick with the Spexels is that we get quadcopters from Ascending Technologies in Germany, and we customize them with our own LED system that interfaces with their processors, and design our own animations and we have our own procedure how to do the show design on a 3D program and transfer it to our simulator, our software, to turn it into GPS waypoints. So this is the original state of the flight control software. I didn't program it, and I always had a hard time with it, because you probably can see why this might be complicated, because there's a lot of information going on here. And this is practically all the drones here. And all the other stuff that's anyhow hard to read gives us stuff back, like battery status, communication frequency, waypoints, problems. And for instance, the problems were pretty hard to see on this simulator. What you see is a scene from Linz. We usually use a satellite image for the 3D program and start to animate the drones the way we want them. and turn this into the flight simulator software, and the flight simulator software takes practically a collider file from the 3D program and aims to turn it into GPS waypoints. And there's the next issue, because GPS is not very precise, so we always have to figure in inaccuracies, and this makes the whole thing very interesting and always very stressy when we fly somewhere. We then decided to, we did a few shows with this. For instance, the biggest show at the SoundCloud, the Klangwolk event in Linz, where we flew 49 in public and 50 at the rehearsal. And then we used it for that Paramount show in London. I don't know if everybody has heard about this, where we had that Star Trek logo next to the Tower Bridge. And after that, people were approaching us if they could license that software. And we decided we hire somebody who's really good at this and found somebody. This is not very usual. And then we turn it into something like this. And now it looks totally different. Even I can manage it. It's practically, what you see here is a long way to go. These are all the informations about one single drone. So you can work with every kind of single drone. It gives you back the battery status, the communication, the update rate of the communication and stuff like that, and you can handle all of these drones. There's, I have to describe the process a little bit. Usually we go somewhere and do a so-called recce. This is a GPS check at the location, because it's never clear if we can fly, because we're based on GPS. And when we do that recce, I'll show you a video afterwards from the United Emirates, where we recently did a recce. We decide how far we have to space them, because they have a certain starting and landing grid, and how far away in the sky each of one should be from the other, because the point is, they are not that intelligent. They don't know where the other drone is. They have no self-conscience. They constantly feed us back with information about what they're doing, but they're not aware of it, of their neighbor. So that's why we need a very tricky system to figure in possible collisions and stuff like that. This is how we do it in the 3D program. It took us a while to figure this out, and there's practically two people in the future lab who can do this. They designed the show design on 3D Max. They export it as a collider file, and we have a way to integrate it in our flight control system. And I will show a little video how this works. This is a scene from that Klangwolke event when we flew the 49 quadcopters. Where is it? So we're using a satellite image as a reference. There's a zero, the so-called ID zero is the drone that is the reference for all other drones. So in the simulation, we start with a positioning for the zero drone and then reference all other drones to that zero drone. This is very important in the end, because when we export this to our flight control software, it's done the same way. We really have to fix a position for the zero drone in the airfield, and then everything else is practically based on it. That's usually not that easy, because if we take a satellite image from Google, they're not very reliable, so we always have to go there a few weeks before the show and check out if the satellite image is accurate. If not, we have to adjust the show on site. I think there might be a lot of questions about this later, but I just go with you through this whole thing. One second, where we are. So this is a picture from a recent trip we did to the United Emirates. So we managed to put our flight control software on a Wacom tablet, and we just go there with a single drone, have all the data here, like the GPS data, the signal, the satellites available, how big the update rate is. We are communicating on 2.4 gigahertz. That's very good, but sometimes with Wi-Fi around, not so good, but usually we can manage this. And we just go there with it. This is the so-called grid. This is how we would space the copters in the end. And we go there and fly a single drone directly at the stage. This is an amphitheater we are going to fly. We just go there, check all the GPS, record everything, check out how high we should go, check out the viewing angle, define the airfield, and take back all the data with really exact GPS positions, because in this case, for instance, they made the island smaller because they worked on it for a while and then suddenly it was a little smaller. So that would mean that our airfield is not here anymore. It might be here, and then they sometimes put obstacles somewhere. Then we have to rearrange everything, and this is the way we do it. And I show you a short video what a wacky looks like. So this is practically a pixel, a space pixel we fly. This is somewhere you might see somewhere around Dubai. And we just fly it with our flight control software. So there's no remote control involved or something. It's just a tablet and a communication equipment, a LERT modem, and we just fly it around, record everything, take the data home, and then turn it into a show. And the client usually is not aware of these complications. I mean, they just say, okay, we have a big show and we want to do this, and can you please fly for us? And we have to start the negotiation then. For instance, this is going to be our airfield. Then they put stuff like that in, and we don't want that. And I don't know if it's still there when I come back in a few weeks, and so stuff like that. And this is a really lengthy process. And if the GPS in that area is not good, then we're anyhow in trouble, because then we might have to negotiate a different airfield. But this seems to work in this case. And then when we come back for doing the show, we come back with 30 drones or something, maybe more in the future. And then the whole thing starts again. We have to position them, check the GPS for all of the drones in the airfield, are they communicating, and starting test flying that. And that's the moment usually when the client gets very interested, because then they finally see what we're talking about. And it's the same thing for you. I'm just talking about it, but it's way cooler to see it, because on video, it's just a 2D thing, and it's not really awesome. But in my opinion, because I'm always there, it's way more cooler to be there. But I show you a short sequence afterwards of a few things we've done. So then you might get an understanding. So this is the tablet that I was talking about. For now, we always had to take a big laptop there, a big beast, and now we managed to do this on the Wacom tablet. I don't know if any designers here, but now it's really cool. We just have one drone and that Wacom tablet. And the antenna, this is the communication equipment for the wacky. It looks cooler afterwards, but at this stage it's like this. So this is a scene from Sweden where you can see how the airfield is built. It's like really starting, this is the drone number 4, but we start with the drone number 0 and then we space them out. And every drone has a certain ID, so the flight control can reference it and talk to it. This is very important. If we mix up the IDs, then the flight control software talks to the wrong drone. And the LED animation in itself that I would like to show you, but I don't know if it's going to work, otherwise it's a video, is preloaded on the drones. In the beginning, we broadcasted the GPS waypoints and the LED animation, but this was really clocking up the 2.4 gigahertz channel, so we decided to preload it. That means that we need a certain show element already fixed with the music and everything, and then we can design the animation and preload it. And it looks roughly like this. If we do an LED sequence, then we practically export the file like this. It's not very spectacular, but you can see that it's just practically just instructions how to switch on and off the LEDs, and we have RGB values. We can use any values we want. And because this thing at the moment is not working, I'll show you what it looks like. There's a big LED system down here. This is something we added to the quadcopter. It's just, without that, it's practically naked. It's just, we did the top cover And here are the LEDs. If I switch it on, you see it. It's pretty light. Good morning. We blind ourselves every time with this. But this is awesome because in the night you really see it. I mean, there's no more complaints about, oh, can I see this? And if it's far away, blah, blah. No, you can see it definitely for a few miles. I mean, there's a certain drawback because it needs power. And with quadcopters, everything is about payload and power. But we really fight for every gram, and now we really managed to get this done. If anybody wants to hold it, it's pretty heavy with the batteries already. But it flies very good. And so this is just a lengthy process. We're still working on it. We're always thinking about what can we reduce, what could be gone, and stuff like that. And we, with our drone partner, they're watching us very closely, and they're always amazed what we're trying next again. Okay, there we are. So what you see here is I'm sorry if it's not so much about programming, but I told you I'm not a programmer. I'm telling you the whole system, how it works, okay? This is our communication equipment. These antennas, the placing of these antennas is extremely important. They should face north and should hit these quadcopters. I show you where the antenna is, somewhere from this side. If we don't get that, there's the antenna. If we don't get that right, we have a communication problem. And these things move really fast. They're around usually 2 meters per second, but we started speed testing now because we got bored. And it's now 6 meters something we can go, and that's super fast. Because the point we have is that we start them in groups. I think I have a picture somewhere about this. Yeah, I see this. We start them in groups so they have different colors. And what this is very important for us because we can start them in groups, and then the important thing happens in the air. We have to regroup them and take them into an animation start position. And that takes a while, and that takes battery. And then from there, we have to fly over there where they want their show, and then we start practically the show. And that's why we recently started to fly faster. And if anybody is going to see it in the future, maybe at the festival, it's going to be faster. It's going to be very interesting. I'm really excited about it. So this is another scene from Yumiya where you can see that even with heavy wind, you can really place them pretty good. I mean, this is not correct because there's a spatial experience. It's not a 2D experience like on that picture. So, and to show you, I'm sorry because it doesn't seem to work, to show you what they're really doing, I show you a short sequence of the last festival where we the first time used that new LED system. And this gives you a really good impression what is artistically possible with this. 550, okay. I can't remember that, sorry. So this was at the Ars Electronica opening at the Tabakfabrik where we flew from... Oh, this is nice too. Something for you. Wait, there it is. This is with a quadcopter done. A quadcopter in the swarm filming the swarm from above. I think that's quite beautiful. I mean, the quality of the GoPro is not that super, but in the future it might be awesome. I think this is sooner or later forbidden because they have a new drone law, so I don't know if they're going to allow this, but okay. And what I wanted to show is that we are often asked is to sync the projection or the video mapping or whatever they do on the stage with the quadcopters. And here we tried some lip syncing. The video is slightly out of sync, but it should show you what I mean, how fast you can trigger that LED system. I know, has anybody been to that festival opening? Only the usual suspects. I think you should start here somewhere. Yeah, this was the special request, but it was a huge projection, and then we practically faked it that the particles that go up there end up in the quadcopters, and then it should start. Yeah, that's the point. And then we start to interact with it. So this is my favorite thing to do with drones, because it's just amazingly beautiful and everybody likes it. Even very important people really like it. And yeah, it's you know, we're artists, you never know, but very important people like it. And so this is pre-stored. If we want to do this via communication, it wouldn't work. That's why we switched to pre-storing the animation. So that means in the end that we are working time code based in a show, and really have to get it right somehow. We did it so far with walkie-talkies, but we're working now on an integration of a timecode system, MIDI-based timecode system, in the software itself. Yeah, I hope a little forward, because there's some cool guy you might like that... sorry, I go back. He will come again, because this is Mr. Einheit from the Einstürzer der Neubauten, if anybody knows him. Or maybe you're too young. So it was a blast to work with him. Really, really enjoyable. So you know, this was last year's edition. We are not quite sure what we're going to do this year, but let's see. Okay, I don't know if you know that stunt we did. It's just it was the famous Paramount stunt for Star Trek in London, where we unannounced flew the Star Trek logo in London next to the mayor, to the Rathaus, and we managed to fly one of the copters in the Rathaus, but nothing nothing happened. He wasn't in his office. So, and this really got us going, because in the end it was just, I think it was 600,000 views on the internet, and even the Star Trekers, they really liked it too. And then we got a lot of requests, and then we thought about how we could turn this into a viable business model. Rent it out, and it looks like that a lot of people are interested in renting this practically. I got confused with my own thing here. Yeah, man, this is the moment where I should try to show you the LED animation, but I'm not quite sure if it works. No, it's not going to work. I'm sorry about this. Yeah. It does a color cycling like you have seen, but I can't show you because it's not going to work. It should work that the alert modem is communicating with the drone and shows you some color cycling. I will just, while I'm talking, try to restart it one more time, and then maybe it works, but I don't think so. So, okay, back to the software. I guess you might be interesting how the whole thing is done. With the original version, it was done in OpenGL, this one. And we really thought about how we could turn this into a product that could be licensed. Licensed would mean that the handling is so easy that it can be installed on Windows and people really know what to do with it. We had a lot of work to do when we flew in Australia, because the civil aviation authority there got worried about our show there. They forced us to define a lot of security features we had before but didn't document, like a geofence. When the drone is leaving a certain area, it automatically descends or gets flown back, and we have now features like we can really send them home one by one. If they go too far, we lose communication. We can send them home, and this is all in the software. There's really nice buttons where you can just watch them, even if they have a battery loss, we see all of this and can react to this. So we decided to turn this into a C++ program, a modular program where we can freely add something all the time. And it is now in a status where we could, with a proper training, hand it over to somebody. If he gets the quadcopters, we train him on him, he gets some maintenance training, we could probably hand it over. We're working on it if it really works like this, because usually we know it's not that easy, because these quadcopters sometimes do something like this one. And so, but this would be the way to go. So this is a very advanced status now of the software. And if anybody is interested in learning more about it, you can freely contact us. And as soon as it's not too special, we probably could really answer your questions how we approach this. It looks like at the moment that we are the only ones flying outdoors warm. We are not sure why, since 2012. Two more minutes. Well, I'm that slow or that fast? I thought, okay. So in a certain sense, we seem to be pretty advanced with this. And some people do indoor flying, but to do massive outdoor shows, obviously, we are the cool guys at the moment. And what you might expect in this year, if we get through all that legal stuff and all that stuff like that, we might fly away bigger swarm. If we do this, you will see it on YouTube, definitely, like everything. And so our next plan would be to really fly up to 100. We could do this already, but we need somebody who wants to finance that stunt, because these quadcopters are very expensive. But you might see it in the future. And to end this, because I have only 1 minute left, I want to show you something. It's just to end this on a hilarious note. It's just not, I don't, it's not meant completely seriously, but what I would like to do is like this. We're going on a 7 Wonder World tour and fly all these great places. So that's it. Thank you very much.